morning, everyone.
Morning.
Thank you. This is only like one of my very first or second times giving a Dharma message, so I appreciate your support and holding this container space for me this morning. I usually have my other Dharma sisters with me, Tina and Roz, but they were out of town and I got called to serve this morning. So thank you. I'm just a little bit nervous, so it might take me a few moments to just completely arrive here. So this morning I wanted to begin with a message that I hope that will convey a term that's kind of been elusive for me as a Buddhist, and I feel like I've been Buddhist my entire life. However, this term of bodhisattva has been very elusive for me. So I wanted to talk about what is a bodhisattva anyway? That's kind of like the working title. Oh, my mic. Sorry, I need to turn my mic on. Thank you, Sandy. Can you hear me? Is it on yet? It's on now. Okay. Did you hear the introduction at all in the back?
Yes.
You're okay. All right. So the topic is, what is a bodhisattva anyway? And I'd like to begin with it's a prayer or part of a sutra. So we can begin with Gassho, please. May I be a protector to those without protection, a leader for those who journey, and a boat, a bridge, a passage for those desiring a further shore. May the pain of every living creature be completely cleared away. And may I be the doctor and the medicine, and may I be the nurse for all sick beings in the world until everyone is healed. So this is a promise that was made by a monk in the 8th century named Shantideva. And he lived during the 8th century, and he attended this university called Nalanda University, which was a really famous university in India. This is a vow and a promise that the Dalai Lama is said to make every morning during his morning meditations when he wakes up at something like 3 a.m. every morning. And it's quite a wide and lofty vow, don't you think? It's like a promise to make, and it seems like literally impossible. But yet, he made this and he wrote this prayer so many hundreds of years ago. To be a protector, a leader, a reliever of pain and sorrow, a healer in many ways. Shantideva was said to be kind of a slacker in today's terms. According to Pema Chodron, who has written extensively about Shantideva, she said that he was perceived as not showing up for his studies. He was perceived as not studying very much. And then he would come to practice sessions late if he arrived at all. She has a really famous quote, and I can't quote all of the words here, but she said that he was famous for, let's see, his three realizations in the writings by his fellow monks. They said that his three realizations were eating, sleeping, and going to the bathroom. So he wasn't really revered by his classmates at the time so much. But one day, at one point, he was goaded into giving a talk to the entire university. And he delivered a famous talk. Now it's called The Way of the Bodhisattva, a guide to the Bodhisattva's way of life, or entering the path to enlightenment. And his vow, as Dr. Haneda spoke about just a few weeks ago when he was here, was kind of childlike, if you really look at it in those terms, and kind of naive to think, like, how could one person save, heal, be a bridge, a boat to everyone until everyone is healed? But I think that's what Dr. Haneda was getting at when he talked about having an innermost aspiration, I think that that's, I think that's what he said, the essence of what he said, and I've had to look through my notes and also listen to Dr. Hanetta's talk, because it can be very, very deep, his talks. But that's kind of the essence that I got out of it, and that's why I wanted to choose this topic today. This works. What is a bodhisattva anyway? Because I think as Buddhists and as Mahayana Buddhists, we might be asked this question, and I always felt it really daunting, because the bodhisattvas I've always seen have been pictured in books, and I've gone to museums and traveled, and I don't know if they were a real living being, or were they some sort of a mythical figure. And so I'm hoping that I can relay in a way that we can start to talk about, when someone asks us, what is a bodhisattva? Is it possible for a human being to be a bodhisattva? Or is it just some sort of a lofty ideal? So I've wondered, like I mentioned, what a bodhisattva is anyway. I wonder if anyone else here has wondered that or not been super clear about what a bodhisattva is. I know when I was growing up, there was a really popular song by Steely Dan called Bodhisattva, and I thought it had a really catchy refrain and chorus, but I didn't really know what it meant. I thought it was kind of cool to be Buddhist because they had a song called Bodhisattva, but I never really understood that as a teenager. And then I came to find out that, I told Ted this morning that the Beastie Boys recorded a song called The Bodhisattva Vow, and I think it might have been in the 1990s or maybe the early 2000s. But I read the lyrics, and the lyrics are really beautiful, and it's very similar to the Shantideva vow, but it's in a rap, and it's got this punk flavor to it. So that was really inspiring to me, because it was something that was modern, kind of a modern interpretation of the bodhisattva vow. So I knew a bodhisattva was a good Buddha-like figure, and thought maybe it was a non-living being, because maybe it was a mythical figure because of all of the kind of strange depictions of it that I would see when I was a younger person, when I was a teenager. Sometimes I saw it with many, many arms, like 1,000 arms and many heads, and I thought, that just seems too mystical. I can't really figure that out. What is the reason for that? But then I've come to realize that being on this Mahayana path, we're at this branch of Buddhism called Mahayana Buddhists, and that's kind of the core of our teachings. I don't want to say it's the most important thing, because that's up to Dr. Hanetta. He has many like most important points, but I think it's the core of the Mahayana way, or the Mahayana pathway or teachings, so to speak. So I considered Amida Buddha a bodhisattva before the Buddha became enlightened. I think he was on the bodhisattva path himself. That Dharmakara in our the chant, we chanted Jusege and Sambutsuge, that Dharmakara is chanting and reciting his aspirations of becoming a Buddha someday. So it's basically, to me, it's a bodhisattva in training, in kind of like modern words. So can a living being be a bodhisattva? Is it possible to ever meet one? Can any of us here aspire to be a bodhisattva? This is one of the depictions of a bodhisattva called Avalokiteshvara, and in our tradition we call her, him, they, Kanon, or in our service books referred to as Bosatsu. In China, it's referred to Kuan Yin, and this is a male form, but I think that they have female qualities too, and I really like that. I like that it could be interpreted anyway. It could be neutral. It could be all things, and I also think that that's a very modern way of looking at a bodhisattva. Bodhisattva of compassion hears the cries of the world. And also, there are many, many bodhisattvas. So the bodhisattva of compassion is not the only bodhisattva. I'm just beginning to learn a little bit about some of the major bodhisattvas in our Mahayana tradition, which I won't have time to go into today. But as Shin Buddhists and members of this branch of Buddhism called Mahayana Buddhism,
It refers to the path of the Bodhisattva, seeking enlightenment for the benefit of all sentient beings. So we're kind, we're all on that, this path together. And I don't think that we've done a very good job of understanding it or learning about it or being educated, or I don't know. It just is, has never been presented to me in that way in all of these years. So this is something that can be attained in one lifetime, so it's not something that takes several lifetimes, and it can be attained by a lay person, so we don't have to enter the path as a monk or a nun in order to realize our bodhisattva nature. Just like realizing our Buddha nature, we don't necessarily, in our tradition, have to enter the path of a monastic. So that's my other way of seeing that we are all bodhisattvas in training. So I took the word bodhisattva and just sort of broke it down, because we're all familiar with the Bodhi tree and where the Buddha was enlightened in India. So Bodhi means an awakened being or an enlightened being, someone who is woken up. And then sattva, these two terms are Sanskrit, and sattva is goodness, wholesomeness, peacefulness, or truth. And that's what those depictions that we see in museums and in books, and sometimes even in our foyer, in the corner there's a golden figure that's kind of tall, that's a bodhisattva, that's Canon Avalokiteshvara, the bodhisattva of compassion. David Nichtern is a Western Buddhist teacher. Some of you may know some of his writings. He's a pretty famous Western Buddhist teacher. And he had a really concise way of describing a bodhisattva. Very simply, he just said they are a kind of compassionate being, and their specialty is helping others. It's a really simple way of just explaining that to anyone who asks you, that it's a kind of being, a compassionate being, who's ultimate desire is to help others. They really dedicate their lives, he goes on to say, toward the well-being of others. So that seems possible. That doesn't seem quite as lofty and, like Dr. Hanetta says, childlike or naive. That we dedicate our lives toward the well-being of others. This next slide is one of those slides that I talked about, the thousand hands. And oftentimes you'll see them and they have things in their hands, and these are all tools. And it's said in some of the Buddhist writings that I've been reading that what happened was that the bodhisattva would find that they could not help everyone that needed help with just this one body. So in one of the myths, they were multiplied, so their hands were multiplied, their heads were multiplied in order to save all beings. So at first, especially to a young person, it looks a little bit mysterious and somewhat like a little scary or strange, but imagine for a moment that this is a symbol that a living being who has the desire and the capacity to help you end your suffering, and who has a thousand tools at her fingertips to offer healing and compassion to all beings with no discrimination. And they will delay their enlightenment until everyone is free, until all beings are free. That's the true essence of a bodhisattva to me. There's a sutra that states that, quote, it is easier to count all the leaves of every tree of every forest and all the grains of sand in the universe than to count the blessings and the power of Avalokiteshvara. So I think that that's a really symbolic way of putting into words what this photograph depicts. And every culture, every country has their own version of this bodhisattva. So sometimes you'll see it with, like I said, with tools in her hands. Sometimes you'll see it with many heads. Sometimes you'll see it seated, sometimes you'll see it standing. So it's something to pay attention to when you notice them now. So we're all familiar with this image, right? This is the image of Amida Buddha. And so we had that talk from Sensei Pollard last week, and then we had a talk by Dr. Hineta that I had mentioned. And in that, he talked a lot about Dharmakara. And Dharmakara was a figure, a historical figure, some people think, and some people think a mythological figure, a figure who wanted to study the Buddhist path and was very, very dedicated. And that's never really, it never really comes right out and says it in English, but it was that he was following this bodhisattva path. And eventually, someone like Amida Buddha, who will preside over the Pure Land. Dharmakara is kind of like the main character in many of our chants in our service book, and basically is a symbol of Amida Buddha. So they kind of go hand in hand with this idea of wisdom and compassion. We talk a lot about infinite life and light. Also could be translated into wisdom and compassion. So lately it's got me to thinking about, what about sentient beings? What about regular people? And part of my studies and part of my path in Shin Buddhism and in the universal care, the universal teachings in Buddhism has been this this idea of finding bodhisattvas in my regular life and looking at figures and people through history, because I do believe that human beings and that living beings can be bodhisattvas. So Amida Buddha, Avalokiteshvara, Kanon are figures, they're icons that are very helpful to us for listening and to study and to think about that sort of like loftiness and that naive quality that allows us to open our hearts and be more wholehearted and to be, to aspire to be those qualities of a bodhisattva, of inspiring goodness, wholesomeness, wholeheartedness, peacefulness, and truth. So who are those qualities? And I just did a few here that I'd like to share with you. So Tenzin Gyatso, that's the His Holiness the Dalai Lama, he's the 14th Dalai Lama, and many believe that he is said to be the incarnation of Avalokiteshvara, of the Buddha, of Bodhisattva of compassion. He's revered by many people inside and outside of Tibet, and also he transcends, I believe, he transcends Buddhism. So when we look at him, we think of maybe, oh, he's the head of the Tibetan Buddhist people. But he's, I think he's become more of a symbol, more than just that. I think he's a symbol to many people who don't identify as Buddhists, as someone who depicts kindness and happiness and compassion and is teaching us lessons. So I think His Holiness the Dalai Lama is a living being, a sentient being. And then I've chosen two others, two other people who are kind of related. And the first person is, before I show you the slide, I just want to talk a little bit about her. The first person, I don't think she ever wanted to enter the Bodhisattva path. I don't think she was Buddhist by any means. She was a real living being just going about her life, doing her work, participating in society and in her community. But she had something, I think, inside of her heart, and she wanted to act. And so she wasn't doing it necessarily for her community, but she had had enough. And that's why I chose Rosa Parks as a bodhisattva. As a bodhisattva, I don't even think in training. I believe she's transcended to being a bodhisattva, to being that person. The real life person who stood up by refusing to give up her seat to oppose racial segregation in Alabama. Except now that one action has had this ripple effect, not only across our country, but across the world. Most people know who Rosa Parks was. So I believe she began a revolution with her one bold action and strengthened a movement of standing up for civil rights. She broke an unjust law that made black people sit in the back of the bus. And it's not that long ago that we had to use separate bathrooms and separate water fountains and seating in restaurants and rooms in hotels. It just seems so crazy and odd now. But that's what began a movement to change the direction of how we live and how we treat one another, to be living in a more equitable society. And so that, I believe, has just touched more than just our society and our culture. And then her wholeheartedness and her actions, I believe, influenced and inspired another bodhisattva in my eyes. Someone who took Rosa Parks' action and led the Montgomery bus boycott in Alabama. Someone who also was not planning on taking on a large role. Someone who was not expecting to rise up in the way that he did. He was a sensei, basically. He was a sensei for maybe a small sangha like this. I don't know the size of his sangha, but he lived in a nearby state, and he had to stand up. He had to rise up. So Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. practiced the art of nonviolence and advanced civil rights through civil disobedience. And what I think that Buddhists would call it compassionate action, wise action or skillful action. Upaya is the term in Sanskrit. And some would say he was a dreamer. How many of these dreams could really come true? With his aspirations that seemed really lofty and unattainable, but also super bold and courageous. Who could think that just one person could stand up and create a change and have, again, that ripple effect? So a religious man who was a preacher from a congregation or a sangha in Tennessee, I believe it was the turmoil of the time that urged Martin Luther King to take further and courageous steps and to become a voice of a dreamer whose actions are felt louder and stronger today. And so to commemorate this week, it was the 50th anniversary of the assassination of Martin Luther King, and there were many, many things going on at the center in Memphis, Tennessee, and one of them was a bell ringing 39 times. He was only 39 years old. But I was trying to be more mindful and commemorate what he stood for. And so this week I reread and listened to the historic I Have a Dream speech, and we've all heard bits and pieces of it, but I really looked at it with that eyes or that thought of, is he a bodhisattva to me? And I urge you to read it because it's very powerful and it's very idealistic, and it grabs you in a place that, it grabbed me in a place that it's not a political speech, it's a speech from his heart of what he desires, what he dreams of. And I think that as bodhisattvas in training, we all have lofty desires, we all have lofty dreams of how we want to treat each other and how we want our society to be. So he was inspiring a generation of young and old to think differently about freedom, about race, economic equity, workers' rights, and he awakened truth and goodness in his words and actions and speech and livelihood. So one of the, at the beginning I shared the Shantideva quote, and it was kind of a poem or a prayer, and then I came across these modern vows or a modern promise, modern bodhisattva vows in the tradition, in the Zen Buddhist tradition, and they really just contain three areas. And one is mindfulness, and mindfulness is being aware of your present moment awareness, having present moment awareness. Basically pausing or stopping and looking deeply at what you're thinking, what your views are, what your thoughts are, because our thoughts can become outside of ourselves, right? They can become our actions. They can be reflected in our speech. They can be reflected in how we treat one another. So mindfulness is at the base of this modern bodhisattva vow. And then to practice kindness, ethical behavior, to practice kindness and non-harming behavior. 3, compassionate action in society or in the world. Instead of saying that I'm going to relieve the suffering of all beings, that maybe I can do something incrementally, a little at a time. So compassionate action in my family, in my community, while practicing mindfulness. Non-harming behavior, as I mentioned, and giving and acting for the benefit of all. So maybe stepping back, that would be for me, stepping back a little bit instead of reacting in the way that I normally would react, maybe to wait and think about responding differently to see if this is going to be a helpful way of being helpful to this person or to this group. Are my words going to cause more division? So it's reflecting more, it's using mindfulness as your tool and as your guide. So these 3 things will include being more open, being less attached to my views, being less dogmatic in my thought, my perceptions, really, really looking deeply at my perceptions, taking care of when I am upset and when I'm angry. Maybe I don't say anything at all, and that's a very, very difficult thing sometimes when we're really caught up in our emotions. Offering an opportunity to speak the truth with speech that is loving, or the speech that is generous and kind. And just living with reverence for life, generosity. Sometimes we call that dana, and wise conduct. Instead of right conduct, I think wise conduct is more open and forgiving there. So I think that Reverend, our Dr. Haneda had mentioned this, you know, what is your innermost aspiration? And I think that's a really lovely open-ended question of what is your innermost aspiration? Maybe who are the bodhisattvas in your life? And they don't have to be perfect beings. We're all human. So there are aspects of people that I admire or that I want to be more like. And I think that that's a really nice grounded way of being. Instead of thinking of a bodhisattva with 1,000 arms and something that I can't always get my head around, I can think about my innermost aspiration of what I want to do on a larger scale, on a lofty scale, on a childlike scale that Dr. Haneda talked about of emptying the ocean one bucket at a time in order to reveal the jewels that can heal everyone or that can heal other people, or the little girl that was using the little shovel in order to reveal the playground that seemed very futile, but she had this sheer determination. So I think we all have that inside of us. That to me is a version of looking at our bodhisattva nature. You know, we always talk about our Buddha nature, that everybody has Buddha nature, but I think we all have this bodhisattva nature, and that's the bridge of, to me, that's the bridge toward enlightenment. It's more of the grounded things that we do every day, the things that I do every day, the small little, the small mistakes I make, or the small strides that I make in realizing or practicing the bodhisattva vows. So you might like to consider who your teachers are, who exemplify goodness or wholeheartedness, peacefulness or truth for you. They could be a family member, they could be a family member who has maybe passed on, could be somebody famous. I know I have a small list. I've never counted how many there are, but you know, when I think about Cesar Chavez, he to me was a bodhisattva. He exemplified so many things to me that were very selfless and truthful, and he took a stand that was in many ways dangerous. He fasted many, many times in order to bring attention to the plight of the workers. Emma Gonzalez is another bodhisattva to me, very young,
17-year-old bodhisattva, one of the students from Parkland, Florida. And then I wanted to end with sharing the third person that I chose is a woman named Reverend Zenju Earthlin Manuel, and she is a Zen Buddhist priest from Oakland, California. She, I'm going to share the poem with you. She's an amazing teacher who I met just 2 years ago, and she's an African-American woman who was brought up in the South and studied Buddhism for the past 25 years. And she has a very fresh way of sharing the Metta Sutra, you know, the Loving Kindness Sutra that we have in our service book. So I wanted to end with her prayer. It's called A Prayer for Our Times, sending peace to all beings. May all beings be cared for and loved, be listened to, understood, and acknowledged despite different views, be accepted for who they are in this moment, be afforded patience, be allowed to live without fear of having their lives taken away or their bodies violated. May all beings be well in the broadest sense, be fed, be clothed, be treated as if their life is precious, be held in the eyes of each other as family. May all beings be appreciated, feel welcomed anywhere on the planet, and be freed from acts of hatred and desperation, including war, poverty, slavery, and street crimes. Live on the planet, housed and protected from harm. Be given what is needed to live fully, without scarcity. Enjoy life, living without fear of one another. Be able to speak freely in a voice and mind of undeniable love. May all beings receive and share the gifts of life. Be given time to rest, be still, and experience silence. May all beings be awake. Please join me in that.